Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the panel Terrorism 3.0, Innovation, Adaptation, Technology. I'm Dr. Gil Arieli. I work at ICT and IBC. I teach here both electronic government and on innovation and adaptation in terrorism and in counterterrorism. And I am honored to chair this panel, which has both extremely distinguished and experienced participants. And I will introduce both the speakers and the panel concepts in two phases. Firstly, how we are about to play out this panel. Let me start with describing that, with your permission. So I'll start with describing the basic concepts and constructs of innovation and innovation in terrorism, and the rationale of the speakers on the panel, which come from very diverse areas. And I'll try to create this coherence and rationale for you. Then we will move to each of the speakers. Each of them will speak about 15 to 20 minutes. And at the end, we aim to have an open Q&A session and a panel discussion, time allowing. Of course, not worry, as in all long panels, we plan to release you guys for a short break, and I will try to play by ear and see when the timing is right. So hopefully, somewhere in between, we'll have a break. That said, let me start briefly by introducing the panel and the speakers. And I will return to each of them with an elaborated background before they present their talk. So, I already presented myself, Dr. Gil Arieli. I'm a retired lieutenant colonel. I research the topics of this panel and teach them here at ICT and IBC. With us, we have Dr. Magnus Ransrock, the research director at the Center for Asymmetric Threat Studies, CATS, at the National Defense College in Sweden. We have Mr. Magnus Normark, a senior analyst at FOI, the Swedish Defense Research Agency. We have Mr. Omri Timianker, who's the founder and president of Cobwebs Technologies in Israel. We have Mr. Ariel Vanon, who's the vice president for cyber and intelligence in Merovu in Israel. We have Mr. Zohar Geffen, who is the director of the security division at Ben Gurion International Airport. Until 3 months ago, today, he was promoted to the head of operations division of Ben Gurion and Israeli Airport Authority. And we have Colonel Shlomo Mofaz, who's both an associate and researcher here at ICT, at IDC, but a former head of counterterrorism analysis department in the Military Intelligence Directorate at IDF. The rationale, if you allow me, I will put on hold for about 7 minutes or so, as I will start with presenting some of the basic constructs and concepts related to innovation in terrorism and counterterrorism, if that makes sense to you. Is that all right? Yeah. So let's speak on innovation. Innovation in terrorism, and we'll speak on counterterrorism as well, is essential in an under-researched area in terrorism studies, as it has been acknowledged. It is evident in many of the terrorist organizations and the incidents around us, sometimes overlooked by experts and the layman, from the Tamim Tiger to Hezbollah to Daesh, ISIS these days. We will try throughout this panel to touch base on some of the events and the experiences. Some aligning ideas I would like to put out to you up front, as I do when I research and teach this topic. Firstly, innovation, be it technological, organizational, or techniques, is not just innovation. Innovation is also incremental changes, adaptation, and learning patterns in organizations. Knowledge is the raw material of innovation. Innovation happens at both sides, and it is connected, and triggered sometimes by the adversary innovation and adaptation. Thus, it's what I've been calling for more than a decade a learning competition, a competition on who learns and adapts faster. And as an outcome of any competition, we need to understand the competitive edge, which here is knowledge. That said, let's try to decipher this term, innovation, which has become so common in the jargon, in the business arena, and in the security studies arena as well. So I could abort all of you, ladies and gentlemen, with a myriad of definitions on innovation. The literature, as our colleague and friend John Alkira writes here in Predicting Military Innovation, the literature is replete with definitions. We won't go there. I am aware we are all after lunch, and one of our tasks for all of us to enjoy and benefit from the panel is to stay sharp and engaged. So we won't go there. This was just a threat not to be included. Let's speak on real life events. Let's speak on the recent terror attack in London. I'll give only one example, in fact two. But this example is exactly what we may not perceive as innovation. We have seen running in Europe attacks. We have seen knife attacks. What's innovating about a knife? Well, quite a lot, in fact, as we will see today. You see, ISIS uses innovative communication theories in making sure that it permeates an idea virally that is about ramming, stabbing, using weapons which are not even perceived as weapons, your vehicle. At the same time, you see the outcome. You see the pictures. And let's speak about disruptive innovation. And I could go, as I hope to do at the end of the panel, and twining all the concepts together, into the definition of what is disruptive innovation, which is called like that by Professor Clayton Christensen, not because it disrupts our life. But disruptive innovation is, first of all, this suicide belt in the London attack. Were you aware of it? It's a fake suicide belt. But the effect of a fake suicide belt as a weapon, which is created of nothing, empty beer cans, as you can see here, is disruptive innovation. And to prove the point, let's see the outcome. You see the outcome here on the left? With no one after lunch? Point to me the error in the slide. I do this to my students to keep them awake after lunch.
It's not London. Not London.
Italian.
It's from the Juventus.
Yeah, so this actually did happen in the same day. But this happened in Turin. In Turin because of a stampede in which 1,500 people were injured. And by the way, this was not a terrorist attack. It was just a cracker that was open. But at the same day of the attack, a stampede creating casualties means that the innovative weapon may only be a megaphone for speaking. And I've been saying that more than a decade ago when I was invited to speak before the Queen's Jubilee in London. I was saying, a threat here may just be a megaphone for speaking. So this is disruptive innovation that not always needs the most sophisticated tool, but sometimes the most sophisticated usage of the less sophisticated weapon. That said, let's look into what's happening just now. I said two examples. So this was one example of what is called disruptive innovation. This is published in Telegram, which again is very innovative as a media. And we will see today that we will focus on the medium that terrorist organizations are using innovatively, the internet, cyberspace. And this was part of a series of field manuals on methodology for attacks published by Daesh. Just now, this is from our OSINT Jihadi monitoring team here at ICT, where they actually advise some additional innovative, disruptive innovative measures, such as you can see behind me, just poison using syringes, food in supermarkets. What can you do in intelligence gatherings against a weapon like poison? So with that said, let's devote, with your permission, a few minutes, no more, to the theoretical construct of innovation. Is that all right? After we've seen this is very grounded and concrete and connected to the actual events and the attacks around us. If that is all right, so let's start, I always prefer to go to the canonical definition. Let's start with Joseph Schumpeter, the economist, in 1934, who actually wrote the initial works on what is innovation in society. Whereas in his definition, innovation is the introduction of new goods, new methods of production, opening of new markets, conquest of new sources of supply, and the carrying out of a new organization of an industry. Let's take this to the terrorist arena. And in my study and in my teaching, I have found that the definition by Schumpeter still applies. It's fully applicable to terrorist organizations as well as to the government sector confronting them. Innovation is the introduction of new goods, where they are technology, new weapons, new methods of production, where they are techniques, TTPs, modus operandi for terrorist organizations. The opening of new markets, where these are areas of governance or constituencies, their audiences. The conquest of new sources of supply, funding, supply chain, and the carrying out of new organizations, which is dramatic in some terrorist organizations as we see organizational innovation there. With that said, I do want to very briefly start from the literature, being both an academic and practitioner in background. The literature of terrorist innovation is, used to be, non-existent to see, and is today a bit more concrete and rigorous. It starts with our good friend and colleague, Professor Adam Dolin's book in 2007, Credit Must Be Due. This was the first book on understanding terrorist innovation that seriously, rigorously analyzed the phenomena of innovation in terrorist organizations. Dolin says that the innovation is the introduction of a new method or technology or the improvement of an existing capability, whereas he differentiates two models. One is what he calls the business model, which is in fact a proactive approach trying to innovate, to be innovative, to be ahead of a market. And the other is the empirical model, which is reactive to demands or things that happen. Professor Marta Crenshaw's definition is that innovation is the adoption of new patterns of behavior, which in terrorist organizations is either strategic innovation, tactical innovation, or organizational innovation. Indeed, in a group of experts which convened in 2010 to discuss and analyze terrorist innovations, they understood terrorist innovation as either tactical, strategic, or organizational, with emphasis placed on the first two, tactical or strategic, where tactical innovation is about inventing or adopting new techniques to unchanging objectives, and strategic innovation entails formulating new objectives, which are strategic in nature. With that said, and I hope that we'll have time in the discussion later on to return to examples or discussion of the constructs, I think that it's important to show some of the existing literature that started with Dolin's book, continued to many other publications, such as Teaching Terror by Frost, or Attitude for Destruction and other literature by Rand researchers that dealt with learning patterns and adaptation in terrorist organizations. However, the recent book published about a year ago on terrorist innovation, understanding terrorism, innovation, and learning, was edited by my good friend, Dr. Magnus Ramsholm, and Magnus Norma, who we are honored to have with us, and will present, and they will be the first presenters of these concepts and their book and findings. Now I think you can see why I started with that and constructed the rationale along the literature development. So very briefly, what we will hear is firstly about the rigorous academic and practitioner research of innovation. Then we will hear from two technology experts and leaders in Israel who will speak about innovations online in the terrorist hands and the way they communicate, the way that they act online, and innovation in countering them online, both using OSINT, open source intelligence, and in the darknet, as we will hear later. To continue the structure of the rationale, we will then hear from Zohar Geffen on aviation security innovation and counter-terrorism innovation in aviation security, which is a crucial field and arena. And Shlomo will then wrap it up with some of the contemporary insights of events and how they connect. Without further ado, I would like to invite both Dr. Magnus Ramsholm, the research director of CATS, the Center for Asymmetrics Threat Studies at the National Defense College in Sweden. He is one of the world-renowned experts that researched terrorism and counterterrorism for more than 30 years. He actually researched and interviewed both Hezbollah leaders in Lebanon and Hamas leaders and wrote on perception
Gaza,
of
West Bank,
wherever they are. And in addition to that, Magnus is the quality manager of the EU Radicalization Awareness Network, and he's also in the Copenhagen
Copenhagen anti-radicalization action plan. I directed the what to do about anti-radicalization in the city. And as we did that, there was an attack on Lars Vilks, the cartoonist, and the Jewish synagogue. So it was a tough portfolio
So though Magnus is from the world leading academicians on the field, he is also a practitioner, it should be said. And with him, we present Magnus Normark, who co-edited the book they wrote and edited, who's a senior analyst at FOI, the Swedish research agency. Magnus is researching terrorism CBRN and terrorism financing, intelligence studies, and counter-proliferation. And he writes on countering terrorism financing and co-edited and wrote the book on understanding terrorism innovation. The two Magnuses, please.
Thank you. I'm going to be very brief. I'm going to let Magnus sing for the lunch or after lunch. I mean, my interest in this topic was really back in 1990 when I arrived in the UK, and my mentor organized a conference that the Royal Overseas League in London, the defense minister was supposed to be there, and lo and behold, the Provisional IRA had was greatly innovative in relation to its operation in terms of tactical innovation. They attacked Downing Street with mortars later on. But I discovered, as I was walking into the conference, that the Provisional IRA had actually planted a porter inside the stall, and they had a lunchbox. And that lunchbox by the porter had lapsed in security. It was all swept. Was planted underneath the lectern, and had it not been for a sound technician checking the cables, at that time, Brian Jenkins would not have been here. Most of the sort of, at the time, very small individuals would not have been here. And that, of course, was a stark reminder that one has to really look at the aspect of innovation, that there is a learning curve, and we've seen that. You know, you all have your own reservoir of terrorist attacks that have happened going back.
We did check all the cables here, as you can see.
No, I can see there's nothing you can put here. So we're also in Israel, so I usually check. That, you know, from Dawson's Field in 1970, blowing up aircraft, you can see similarities. And I'm not sure how much you can draw from that and how much groups actually learn from that. But we saw, and I think all of you knew, and I know especially in the European intelligence community, that the Mumbai attacks was really a stark reminder. Everyone was starting to prepare. This will happen in Europe. This is going to happen. Long, drawn-out cases. I think everyone was sort of starkly worried about that. How many people here have been, I never visited that in Israel, even though I've been a guest there many times. How many people here have been to a bomb display, or, do you have that here in Israel? I've been to Singapore, the Home King, have a great display of all the devices of IEDs. Northern Ireland have a great display of the earliest IEDs and the technical innovations that have happened in terms of the sort of different bomb makers. So I think it's quite important to understand, you know, what is driving this technical innovation and how do you really handle the different facets of this? You know, what is driving the modus operandi of different groups? And you can look at it from through different perspectives. I'm not promoting my book because it's so expensive, or our book, I should say, it's so expensive. We don't get any royalties from it. It's so, you know, it's usually for libraries and universities. So it's not entered into the paperback yet. But we broke it down into different levels. Ideological influences in relation to directives being given by individuals for how to do attack mode. I remember when Inspire came out in the beginning, everyone was laughing at it. No one would read it. No one will digest this. This was sort of the newsweek for jihadism, for those who neither spoke Arabic or didn't understand anything about the ideology. Ideology liked, but it was also, when they came out with some of the earlier pictures, no one was really taking this seriously. And look at where we are today with IS. being even more innovative in terms of giving guidance, of giving tactical advice. I'm sure you've all watched the horrible videos, or at least some of them, if you're working on this issue. The last one I saw was an instructional video from IS showing how do you kill someone, what knife should you use. And in the background was a person sprung up in white, waiting to be executed. He was executed in that video. There has been a shift also in the brutalization of violence and the brutalization of the different methods, which I think works on the issue in terms of the selection. Everyone heard about Fuad Hussein's book that was written as a synthesis of this sort of grand strategy that later would actually pinpoint by the year the establishment of the caliphate and the phases of leading up to that. Now, that came out in 2005. I saw it on the PowerPoint yesterday as something new. Sort of 10 years later, this pops up. That was very evident as something that was in the background, that was being consumed and so on, that was quite important. If you have to look at the ideological influences, what kind of directives are they giving? How is that being absorbed? Particularly also within a group dynamic. So we don't see enough research being done, probably not even in intelligence services, because they don't have time to jump. They jump from lily pad to lily pad trying to find the next attack. They don't have time to synthesize, to think about that. But I think that to really read high resolution data on attacks and to break it down into the learning aspects, into the evolution, we need to have more research on group dynamics, group hierarchies, the role of bomb makers, bomb designers. You know, today, I'm sitting here with someone who will hopefully let me out in a few days, about the role of Yemen and the bomb designers within ACAP and so on, picking up new devices, etc., and the importance of that. So thinking about group dynamics, the technical expertise, and more importantly, and I think this is a really interesting area, I don't think there is anything really written about this issue, and that is how do the terrorists do counter surveillance? How do they conceal themselves? How do they conceal themselves? How do they learn how authorities operate? How do they, and I can give you a good example. The 9/11 attacks were done via what? Anyone remember? How do they communicate the command? They went into Hotmail was popular at the time. They went into having shared username and passwords. And they wrote a draft message and stuff there. That was what, 16 years ago. They talk now about the issue of encryption, but they vary encryption from encryption, personal messengers, etc. So the complexity and the range of communication modes is quite advanced. And there is thinking within these circles. And I remember West Point had a ranking of what are the most watched websites by child communities. These are a few years back. And that was about exchanging security advice of how to stay under the radar sort of intelligence services. That was my little frame. This was the starting point of what we did with the book. And there are all different individual sort of chapters in relation to Al-Qaeda. I'll let now Magnus describe some of those issues in greater depth. I'll come back to the last slide.
Well, thank you for that introduction, Magnus. I was supposed to sing for the lunch, but I don't have any time. Good afternoon. I'm afraid I have to start by apologizing for for this slide. I won't spend any time on it because Jill has already mentioned it. But what I'm going to do is to give you a very brief summary of the study that we did that resulted in this book that we've been talking about. As Magnus said, it's been purely focused on Al-Qaeda-related plots and attacks, foremost focused on European cases. So we had pointed out different thematic chapters on IEDs, counter-surveillance, ideology, targeting, etc. And that we had a separate part for case studies, and specifically linked to cases in Denmark, Germany, and Great Britain. So just a few words about this. We had a very broad, we used the term innovation very broadly in this study, and that is, of course, we wanted to catch the evolution of how this organization changes its tools and its methods, targeting in their operations based on what we've seen. Now this is fairly repeated observation, I think, that terrorists tend to be quite conventional, especially if you think about the weapons that they choose for their attacks. And mind you now that we haven't studied ISIS specifically or the latest year's attacks in Europe. And it's a fact that this organization doesn't really innovate for innovation's sake. There are specific factors that are playing in and influence their decision in these matters. So any innovation requires deviating from the status quo and to embrace a certain amount of uncertainties. And there are several restraining factors that may be at work within a terrorist cell following an attack, both internal and external factors, as Jill has pointed out. Now, given the focus amongst Western security agencies, law enforcement, and CT strategies where today most terrorists would strive to avoid complexities, keep it simple by deploying known tactics and weapons. There might be challenges with performance changes that innovation might require within the cell, but sowing doubts about uncertainties regarding the ability to go through with innovation, successfully perform the changes, regarding the calculated results, the change factors of technologies, will the innovative measure achieve the desired effect? A change in methods or means might require new equipment or specific knowledge that might become substantial thresholds for terrorists itself to acquire, of course. Given all these possible restraining factors, it's fair to conclude that in order for innovation to succeed, there needs to be some degree of risk tolerance, a willingness to tolerate operational failure. So what might be the drivers for terrorists to pursue innovation in their business? So looking at past terrorist organizations embracing this innovation in some form, we can point out some overarching incentives. Of course, counter-terrorist measures, perhaps the greatest impact factor for these groups to change their behavior and methods. Measures to detect terrorist cells before the attack and measures to minimize and mitigate the effects of attack. And measures are often implemented in the light of the last terror attack from a counter-terrorist perspective. So this creates the dynamics, the dynamic context between terrorist planning, the next terror attack, and counter-terrorist measures. So you need to adapt to a context where the stakes for success have been raised, for some to overcome turret hardening measures by employing other weapons or modus operandi, to introduce other means and methods of communication to avoid information leaks, or to make organizational changes to reduce the risk of being detected or infiltrated. A competition with other organizations operating in the same geographical area can be another factor that drives innovation. A number of sub-factors will influence if rivalry will lead to innovation, such as ideological similarities, rivalry between leaders, the greater the overlap in the competitive group's ideologies, goals, and ambitions, the greater the likelihood of innovative tactics or technologies will be introduced by one of these groups. Of course, we have the leader component, leadership component, that may influence innovation in terms of fascination for specific techniques, for specific outcomes that requires innovation. We've seen that in other organizations, specifically, for instance, Shurikyo, Japan, and so on. These organizations conduct operations with the purpose to instill fear and horror, and the wider population, against the wider population than directly affected. So repeated attacks and attack moves could potentially lead to desensitization in the population and therefore create an increasing pressure on terrorists to expand their operational objectives to keep or to raise the publicity level for each attack. So this would be the escalation imperatives on that slide. Thought about what could initiate innovation in a terrorist operation, we should not underestimate the factor of chance. So this could manifest itself through a sudden acquisition of a particular human or material resource. We have seen, for instance, in terms of ISIS, gained access to weapon systems they don't previously have by confiscating them or when they run over military installations or fighting the troops in the war. It's also relevant to think about the impact of specific human resources within the Al-Qaeda organization that has acted as conductors for innovative measures. Al-Qaeda innovation has to a large extent been driven by individuals such as Ramzi Youssef, Khaled Sheikh Mohammed in the early years, and Ibrahim Hassan al-Assili as the Al-Qaeda's main homemaker. And it's also a fact that terrorist organization doesn't fully control who they inspire through propaganda to act on their behalf. It could potentially be an individual with a unique ability or access to use or means and methods than the organization traditionally have preferred and used. Potentially open up for an insider threat within critical functions in Western societies. Just to raise some overarching findings from our study, I'd like to come back to the perspective that terrorist organizations such as Al-Qaeda doesn't operate within the cutting edge of technology development arena. Their behavior clearly shows us that so far they have been fairly satisfied with scanning technology developments that are taking root and spreading through modern society as a whole and finding applications, knowledge and targets that can improve their capacity and opportunities for the business. We've looked at innovation and learning components through Al-Qaeda plots and some aspects stand out in this regard, which you see on the slide. Of course, the art of bomb makers and IED construction is where the true innovation efforts have been made by jihadi terrorists so far. New precursors to produce explosives, new mechanisms to trigger the explosives, new components to increase the destructive capability of the design, new EED designs to fit the device and conceive shapes and goods. A skilled and innovative bomb maker is definitely the most valuable resource for a terrorist organization in the traditional way they act. So, moving to other areas where jihad terrorist plots have shown evolution in various ways, end up with a field that we would categorize as adaptation, imitation, and learning. So internet and social media is one area that in has had where the capabilities for wide variation of purposes actually has gained them a lot of advantages that they didn't have before. The virtual explosion of militant jihadi websites and social media platforms has provided Al-Qaeda and other groups with infinite opportunities and chance for propaganda and recruitment and inspiration. As a tool for attracting support and financing, exchange information on tactics, techniques, and procedures, or to direct operatives on the ground before or during an attack. Mimicking attack mode, I just say that we can find several plots and attacks that have great similarities between them in regards to Al-Qaeda attacks, in, for example, in Europe. When in regard to ideology and strategies, we've seen a development of increasing ideological fragmentation in regards to Al-Qaeda ideology. In contrast to early strategic writings, there is more easily digestible Al-Qaeda propaganda products being spread throughout social media today, offering do-it-yourself advice and, on how to conduct attacks. So this is kind of a bottom-up and advice from below approach. And we have also highlighted the overseas training. It's been specific for Al-Qaeda. Of course, we now have the combat experience that many of the ISIS jihadist foreign fighters have gained through traveling to Syria and Iraq. And this, of course, give them a lot of knowledge and skills. And also, this is environments where they have the ability to develop their methods and tools, potentially to provide the attackers with proper capabilities when they're going back to their home countries. Max, I don't know, do you want to take the last slide? Or?
We thought about what are the areas where we should be sort of looking at, and that is really listed here on the slide in terms of looking at the composition of cell structures, plots, particularly where that technical expertise sort of resides, the operational planning cycles that occur. I wanted to make a special plug on terror finance because we wrote a piece, we've done some studies on how, for example, the Swedish foreign fighters were funding themselves. Most of the big money is in Syria and Iraq, plundering, taking up oil, reselling it, etc. But very little work has been done across Europe on terror finance. I mean microfinance. So we interviewed all the security, intelligence, all the people who have great operational insight. And one conclusion we had was that there was no absence of money. There was huge money, and they were quite innovative in the way in which they raised that money, not only through fraud, student loans, yes, I mentioned some of them yesterday, but also crowdfunding locally, using the internet as a sort of space. And I remember when Hezbollah used to put in ads in the paper that members of the Lebanese resistance movement, you can sponsor them, you can sponsor a bullet, you can sponsor a flak jacket, etc. That same thing is going on in the arena that you see in Lebanon today. You shouldn't be surprised, but it is really interesting area. So they are scouring everything from bitcoins to all these different new areas using different cutout systems in terms of making contact, but also how do you transfer sort of the funding. So terror finance is also very important because mapping that reveals individuals that you wouldn't otherwise find. And yes, everyone's doing that in intelligence and law enforcement, but actually putting them together. I was very surprised when we went around different European states and said, look, how are they funding themselves? Yeah. But and so on. And to tell you the truth, I'm not sure if they really knew. They may know individual cases, but not totality. You know, what is the totality? We were further not surprised to see that money is coming in, being transferred from these dealers back into, for example, Europe. So we need to understand those, et cetera. Also, ID concealment. You know, today, the United States understood one thing after 9/11, that was that they not only had to erect big walls, but they also had to verify identities. Many other countries are catching up. There's a lot of identity theft. So there's a big business in human trafficking. Understanding that world and how that intersects with terrorism is quite important. And then lastly, state involvement. I mean, I didn't mention very much on Hezbollah, Hamas, but people heard Hezbollah. What does the state involvement do in terms of your geographical reach, in terms of your ability, and therefore, I know even after 9/11 in the West, in the U.S., even despite what had happened in the U.S., there were people who still haven't forgotten what happened in Lebanon with the Marine barracks, with Hezbollah's modus operandi, Hezbollah's global reach. And that is important to remember, that it is an organization that really is intimately interconnected to Qasem Soleimani's IRGC, Quds Force units, and that makes them sort of in a special category. But we're very humble because it's a reservoir expertise who knows how that group operates. But I think it's important to see that I think the U.S. and others are still concerned about their role, their involvement in operations. So I leave that as sort of an open invitation to do more research, to do more knowledge, and particularly connecting the technical aspects, the behavioral sciences, with terrorism research. So thank you for inviting us.
Thank you very much. I think based on the rigorous academic findings we've heard so far, it is in time to look into the empiric arena of cyberspace and see the innovations of terrorist behavior there that we started to build. Let me invite Mr. Omri Timianker, who is the founder and president of Cobweb Technologies in Israel. And it should be mentioned that Omri began his way in the IDF Special Forces and Israeli Secret Service, where he was one of the pioneers of tactical SIGINT operations. Most people here come with operational background before their practitioner, grand practitioner, academic.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much. Thank you for hosting us. So before I introduce myself, I would like to start with a short story that usually wakes the people, and secondly, give a little bit aspect about our challenges in this world. So two people are going to the jungle, and suddenly a big lion starts to run at them. So one turns away and is starting to run away from the tiger. The other one sits down and changes gear to a running gear. So his friend comes to him and says, "Hey, what do you do? Are you crazy? Do you think you're going to run faster than the tiger? And do you know what he done it? No, I'll run faster than you." And now, it's a short story, but it tells a lot about our challenges in the world of operations methodology, that we need to adapt ourselves all the time to new methodology, new arenas. And in the R&D, we need to adapt ourselves all the time to new technology, new collection, new analysis, and this is what I would like to talk about. So, my name is Omri Timianker. I'm 39 years old. I like to say that I'm married with 3 children. You get to know me better. And again, my background is operations. I'm coming from the field. In 2005, I left the Secret Service, and since then, I'm a founder of companies specialized in intelligence, especially tactical intelligence, because as we know it from the field, intelligence and operational mission success is life. So when I founded Cobweb 3 years ago, that was a very crucial point of big data and the difference between big data and technical, let's say, technical solutions to something much, much more easier. I will not talk about technical thing. I'm not trying to sell anything over here. Okay? We are over here in academic place. I'm just trying to show you with two examples about how we can use the arena of the webbing and the open source, one already existed, in order to catch things. And the second example will be the future, but not so much fantasy in the near future. So the title, Synthesis, Automation, and Artificial Intelligence. I will start with one case, because we like to show operations and success. We were 2 months ago in Europe, in some agency, and part of the test that they gave us for our system was, okay, take two profiles, Facebook profiles of someone, and the only thing that connected between them was that they mentioned Syria. That's it. So, we went to the system, and as I mentioned, sympathy, Google style. One of the most important things that I learned as an end user, that if it's not simple, I will not use it. And part of the solutions that they have today, a little bit complicated, you need IT guide. And the idea that we did the company was Google for Intelligence. The experience of the end user should be very, very easy. They know how to go to Google, they know how to go to Facebook. We need to give them the same experience. So the simplicity is this, only one checkbox. After that, we just put the name that they gave us, and we got two targets. Target one and target two. Target one, Facebook account, very small one, 15 friends. We can collect all the information about these Facebook friends, Facebook locations, and on, nothing connected to target two. Again, target two, 20 friends, something very small, not a lot of posts, not active one, but probably this is the account that they open in order that someone will connect with them, some of the recruiter will connect them. We did a cross analysis. That means that we took the two entities, the two Facebook accounts, in order to see what is connecting between them. Sometimes it can be nothing, sometimes, and over here, I think that we need a jackpot because I will show you what we put. This account is combining the two bad guys, the four friends of the right one and the three friends of the left one. You can see that the pictures are a little bit suspicious. You can understand that maybe they are bad guys. The person in the middle, no picture. When you go manually to his Facebook account, locked, privacy, no friends, nothing, you can't see anything. So you can say, okay, this is just an avatar, someone that it's not so important, but because we want to show them the power of the system, we analyze this account. And what we got over there, I think, was very amazing, even for them, and I will tell you the end how it, at the end how it finished. But what you see over here, part of the information that we collected. If you see at the top, summary, post, media, this is all the information that collected from his Facebook account, even though it was private. And now I would like to talk about automation. I think one of the most important things is that the user, the analyst, and I'm not talking about Israel, but let's say we are smarter and people have a lot of knowledge. I'm talking about tier two, tier three countries that are a little bit less IT guys. Everything should be done for them. They just need to click the button, like Google, and they will get all the information. And the profile over here is the same. You need a very strong backend to collect information and to make the visualization that will bring in a nice picture. What we see over here, this is part of the post. You can see this is a very active account, 1,013 posts. Most of them he published. Most of them, it's, if we will filter it, we're going to do it right now, you will see Kiel, you will see Syria, you will see Turkey, you will see many, many keywords that are some of the ISIS recruiters' portfolio. And what you see on the map, this is location on his friends. So the system took all these person friends, and I will show you how much you have, and put them on the map. So immediately you can see the area of Kosovo and Albania, many of his friends. But what's much more interesting is to see that they have a friend in every Europe big city, Berlin, in Belgium, in Zurich, in France, in Italy, and after that, in Turkey, and after that, in Syria, just on the border with Turkey. So you can see, imagination, your route of recruiters, how maybe these people are the hunters, because this is how they act, the hunt. So this is the hunters at Facebook that engage with those people, to recruit them, and then he's going to this school in Syria to get them. So we continue. Media. I just speak Arabic, but I gave it to someone. That means go kill all the people in Fallujah. Okay, using knife, using knife, what? But this is, let's say, the propaganda that he is doing in Facebook. Only you can see Mosul, the maps that reflect that are for ISIS. You can see that this is ISIS. And we go to this friend. As I mentioned, no friends to show. By organization, we can bring the friends even without being his friends. So we're not using avatar network in order to connect with him and then to be his friends. Everything done automatically. And you can see more than 1,000 friends. And over here, the size of the friend is part of the algorithm to filter it, closeness. So you can see the best friend, 186 mutual connection. I think this is a person that's very relevant for him. So from this demo that we did, and we just wanted to show the articulas, you know, okay, do a live demo. They established to arrest the most, let's say, the senior recruited in this area. Now he's down from Facebook, he's not there. But for me, as an intelligent person, I want now to analyze this person, and this person, and this person, and all the network that over here, in order maybe to put some honeypots, maybe to create a certain avatar that will engage them, and then I can arrest other recruiters. So it's intelligence, but at the end, we are talking about intelligence collection. How we can create a good operation from something that we gather, from open source, from two Facebook accounts, not related to each other, small one, no one will pay attention to them, and then to catch a bad guy. That's one example. Now I want to go a little bit to the future. It's not so far in this future, I think it's over here, artificial intelligence, everybody doing this buzz and machine learning, we're talking about it a lot, but most of the technology already matured. Now it's only the matter of how we can integrate it into one system that will help us to make human insights in seconds. So, this is part of the thing that we're proud to do with ICT, how to maybe identify or give alert about a terrorist from his profile account. So part of the thing is scoring. We have a lot of information, and if some profile account is talking about flights, Syria, ISIS, Turkey, doesn't matter, with some percentage, then we can give red flag, maybe this guy is not a good guy, maybe let's check him a little bit more. So this is one thing that we are going through with the academic research, with the ICT, with Eitan and with Boaz and his guys. The other thing is machine learning. So I'm not a technical guy, so this is what they told me how to pronounce it. After that I will go to the practical area. Classification or releases, regression. Do you remember the story of the issue with the shooter from Alessandria that happened in the USA in June? That a person that didn't like the Republicans and went to Alessandria and shot seven Republicans on a Sunday morning on a baseball court. So I was in Washington that day watching CNN. I heard the name and then I established to analyze his account. He had another account. This is the account that he made more propaganda, more radical propaganda over there. And over there you can see the regression. Before the shooting, much more posts, much more radical posts. Trump is a traitor, we need to kill everybody. Really, really astonishing post. If someone will see the regression, how it goes, even the sentiments of the post and the activity graph, then maybe it's another red flag that someone can put. And the third one is clustering groups. So everything is over here today, right? We have what they did, a gun, a mouth, a person, already exists. Technology, Google have it, Microsoft have it, many companies have it. So the classification is over here already. We have regression because we can put some pattern and understand, okay, when you change from this to that, give me an alert. And of course, we have clustering. If I will take a personal Facebook account of someone and I see this is the same family name, probably this is family. And this is from the same school, this is friends from school. So we can give already clustering, already doing that, that, and that. But how we do it in operation in order to bring something to the table. Let's take this example. It's not a real example, but it can be. So we have over here a post. Last stop for a goodbye party. The guys in the name of Allah, they are mercy, they are merciful. And we have over here a picture. That means that the picture posted and made the last post. I think most of the incident today, people are posting before they're doing it, saying goodbye. What can we do with this? We have two things over here. One, alert mechanism. If I will search the web monitoring keywords, maybe I can catch this one and then to do something. The second is from this picture. I have a picture over here. It's a temple, probably. Now, using all the technology that already existing, so I can take this one and maybe go part of the thing is the technology, but at the end, the projector will not work, so then nothing works. But then maybe to go, and it will load in a second, and to scan it in the internet, to find similar location, similar picture like this, in other places, and maybe to catch the place and the location. 1 second, I hope it will load. If not, I think you got the idea. Using synergy of many, many kinds of technologies. Alert mechanism, NLP, sentiments, face recognition, picture recognition. From this post, at the end of the day, so now this is all my technical capabilities. Yes, I don't know how to fix, but from this post,
we believe you.
I'm saying this is imagined, but it's the new future. So everything as exists, you just need to put it in one system and make optimization. Again, the client experience should be very, very Google style. Everything should be done for them. Do you have any questions? I'm here until we finish, and I'll be happy to answer you. Thank you very much for your time.
The session is part of technology, obviously, records its name, and can be reopened the slides for Amiel. Thank you, Amiel. And now, without further ado, let's continue what we have seen that could be done using AI, what is being done. Now we will slide again. Okay. And let's now go a level lower. I would use the phrase that we have underground. Let's hear of what is happening and how the internet is exploited in the darkness from Ariel Levanon. Two words about Ariel Levanon, the vice president for cyber and intelligence in a very large group in Israel, Mel Group. Ariel Levanon is an expert on cybersecurity and managing complex intelligence projects. In his past, Levanon served as a major in the IDF. In the intelligence unit for 17 years, where he led a number of cyber and intelligence groups. So, Ariel, please.
Okay, good afternoon. First, I have a short confession. Last week, when I talked with Gil, and he told me that I supposed to talk after Omri. So I understand that this is a great challenge. So I changed all the presentation, but I didn't change the joke at the beginning. So I won't tell you again the same joke, but I agree that we should be better these days, so the attackers will decide to deal with our targets. In my short presentation today, I want to talk a little bit about combination.
It looked at first like an attack just on hospitals in the UK, but it's now becoming clear that this malicious software has run riot around the world. Russia, the United States,
it's had tens of thousands of computers showing error messages like the screen here. This was the screen that the UK's National Health Service demanding ransom to unlock the files.
Quiet at the largest terminal, the port of LA.
Yeah, it shut down because of a global cyber attack. CBS's Carmen.
Tonight, new details of how Vladimir Putin's elite hackers may have gone after the campaign of a
active firms in at least 10 different countries, from India to the United States. It was first reported in Ukraine and Russia, which have been the worst hit.
A massive data breach affecting Verizon customers. The personal information of 6 million customers has been...
A massive cyber attack is spreading across the world. It is known as the Petya virus.
And it has... In the program with some breaking news. The CIA has lost control of the majority of its hacking arsenal.
Okay, so the idea that from my point of view, when trying to understand what is innovation in cyber terror and cyber crime, first we must remember what was the last cyber attacks of the last years. So as you probably understand from the field, cyber attacks are very common these days, because at the last year we had ransomware attacks, Petya, we had WannaCry that affect not just the private sector, but also the public sector, affect airports. We had cyber attack against election campaigns like we saw at US and like we saw at French. And we had a lot of new viruses, new malwares, mobile malwares, other. And also we learned, and we saw that also in this film, that NSA tools and CIA tools were leaked to the darknet. So the idea is that today, crime can be done from the keyboard, and it's very easy to make a cyber crime. From my point of view, it's even easier to be a hacker than to be CISO. Because, you know, everything is published in the darknet, everything is published in the public media, and then even a beginner can take these tools and try to operate cyber attack against private sector, against critical infrastructure, etc. So, when trying to understand the combination and still the differences between cyber crime and cyber terrorism, we must make sure that we understand clearly a few things. First, the targets. The targets of cyber terrorists are first to affect the population, to affect critical infrastructures of the country. Criminal hackers are just looking for money or looking for data. They are not looking just to affect the population. They are not caring about that. The motivation. The motivation of criminals, part of the time, is just to have fun. They want to attack companies for fun, for ideologic purposes, for religious purposes, but terrorists want to attack countries and critical infrastructures because they want to make a damage, and this is a huge difference. About the methodologies, terrorists most of the times are collecting data, collecting intelligence on the target, and on the due date, press the button. Criminals are just trying, they are trying to attack by DDoS, they are trying to attack by malwares, by open malwares, by open source. So there are a lot of differences between the cyber crime and the cyber terror. But there is a huge thing that is connected between them, and this is the cyber. And the cyberspace is the space that also the hackers that are dealing with cyber crime are dealing also with cyber terror. It's very similar to physical terror. Part of the time criminals are helping the terrorists. Maybe they know that they're helping them, maybe not. And this is also part of the problem, because the same capabilities that hackers are using for make cyber crimes can be used and are being used also today by terrorists to take cyber terror, cyber attacks. So we look on the cyberspace not just as a technological problem, because you heard from Omri and you can hear a lot and you can read a lot about cyber technologies, about intelligent technologies. There are a lot of technologies today. Sometimes the customers are even don't know what to pick, because there are a lot of similar technologies. But I'm looking on the cyber also as a human problem, because in cybersecurity, the world understands that there is a human problem. Trying to make all the secretaries in organization understand what is cybersecurity and don't press the link. But in cyber threat intelligence, part of the time is trying to expose the man behind the nickname. This is a great challenge, as you're probably aware. Sometimes for that you must hire the most experienced hackers and analysts in the market so you can deal with those hackers in the real life. Sometimes you must understand where are the critical sources that they are dealing with, where are the relevant markets, how can you get the credentials to get into those markets. And also you must collect data by real time, because there are a lot of methodologies where those hackers are posting data and then 2 hours afterwards taking down all the data. So as we see, it's a combination. It's not just the technology, it's also the human problem. And here again, it's very similar to the model terror. The guerrilla terror, when you want to deal with, let's say, Hezbollah, like you mentioned before, or with Hamas, first you must expose the terrorists, and then, just then, you can deal with them face to face. It's also in cyber. First, you must expose the hacker behind the nickname, and just then you can deal with the hackers in physical manners, in legal, if you are a private sector, or in other perspectives when you are a country. I have here a very short use case that I just want to present to emphasize this idea. Here we have a real use case from one of our potential Latin America customers from the private sector, that his problem was just that. How can I expose the hacker behind the nickname that making cyber frauds to my organization? In case that this is a telco, this hacker is stealing the business, the main business of the telco, by selling for free 3G and 4G internet in the darknet, in the Facebook, in the Twitter, and in free markets in Latin America. But when dealing with investigation, I am honestly still not familiar with technology that know how to take all this relevant intelligence, how to take this nickname and bring all the relevant evidence from the virtual world so they can take that to the court. And what we did at the last few months was trying to expose the hacker behind this nickname by combination between few relevant technologies. We collect a lot of data about him, we negotiate with these hackers, but as I mentioned before, still we want to stay confidential because we don't want the hacker to understand that he's under his investigation. And we collect data from the social media, we collect data from open source, we collect data from the darknet. Until a few months ago, we managed to expose the real name of the hacker behind this nickname. And then we at the end found the relevant data that help us to go with our customer to the court. So, the main idea is that at the end, to deal with cyber terror, that it's a combination between technology and human skills. It's a combination between automatic technology that can do real-time analytics, that can do real-time collection, that know how to deliver actionable insights to their analysts and know how to integrate part of their conclusion to security controls almost automatically. And also with analyst skills that know first how to deal with the darknet. I am quite sure that for most of the people in this room, the darknet is a real secret. What is the darknet? How can we deal with the darknet? But I want to tell you, you're right. It's a real secret. It's like navigating the sea without GPS. Most of the people that I'm familiar with are having problems to get home without Waze. So trying to navigate in the sea without GPS, this is the darknet. You must understand where you want to go. You must understand how to get into the forums, How can you collect data? How can you talk in the same phrases, the same languages of the hackers that are from different countries? This is the challenge. So, as I see, and this is the next future innovation, the next future will bring us cyber actionable threat intelligence systems that first know how to collect all of this data automatically, but deliver to the customer just the contextual data. Second, understand how to deliver to the customer, whether this is customer from cyber crime department or from cyber security organization, just the actionable insights. And when we look on the terror, we understand clearly, like it was mentioned here before, that today ICE is using the open web, using the dark net, because they want to achieve more money, they want to achieve more psychological effect, they want to coordinate between their teams, and they also want to publish their achievements. So they are also coming familiar with cyber attacks as I mentioned before, a methodology to affect the population, to affect countries. And we have here a few examples from the last 3 years of the United Cyber Caliphate success operations. But when looking into the future, we see that, for an example, the fighter Muslim Cyber Caliphate now think about ransomware attacks as an operation that can help them raise money. So, as I mentioned before, there is a combination between the cyber crime and the cyber terror, because probably terrorists will use also cyber crimes to raise money from the civilian sector, etc. And at the end, when trying to look on the future, probably we see more and more combination between cyber crime and cyber terror. We see that terror uses the cyber domain as a main probably tool to affect countries, to affect election campaigns, to attack critical infrastructures, to attack water, to attack electricity. And also we see the cyber crime becoming more easy. It will be easier to be a hacker because of the IoT that connect everything and make everything vulnerable. It will be very easy because you can download hacker package from the internet and then, wow, you are a first stage hacker even without understand computer. And because of the IoT and the mobile and that everything is connected but not integrated, the hackers will always find a way to go inside the organization. So probably when talking about terrorism, 3.0, we see more and more cyber attacks in the future, and the main option, as I see, to deal with that will be with the combination of operational intelligence and combine that with cyber relevant skills that can prevent both the attackers and the criminals to achieve their targets. Thank you very much for your time. I'll be here afterwards for further questions.
First thing you need to do after real speech is take this to the 5. Thank you very much, Ariel. I think now you have seen the rationale and the sequence between issues in terrorism innovation still to be researched, as Magnus described them upfront, like financing, the ways of financing, microfinancing, etc. And now you have heard going to cyberspace and underground to the darknet on the potential in the convergence of cybercrime and cyberterrorism. I think this is one of the advantages of teaching and innovation in terrorism. I had students in the midst of the attack on the hospital in the UK that, when I talked about it in class, said, this is cyber, could be cyberterrorism. I said, why? And they gave the answer that you now described as easier. The funding media. I think you are an amazing, brilliant, and attentive audience, and I believe that time, being what it is, we all deserve a brief break as we move from technology to aviation security innovation and terrorist and counter-terrorist innovation in the sky. Let's take a 15-minute break, not in Israeli time. This will be with academic time. 15 minutes from now, we will start the show. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the second part of Terrorism 3.0, Innovation, Adaptation, and Technology in Terrorism and in Counterterrorism. We are now moving from the first part of the session where we spoke on the constructs and the research of innovation in terms of organization, and the lacoon and the remaining research to be done, and technology, innovation, usage by terrorism and against it. Now we move to the unique seminar arena in terrorism, that is aviation and security. We have with us one of the global experts in possibly one of the most innovative aviation security organizations, the Israeli Airport Authority, from which much of the global aviation security was benchmarked after 9/11. Zohar Geffen with us. It is still written, director of the security division at Ben-Gurion International Airport. However, this was his role, as I mentioned before, until 3 months ago. Today, he is the head of operations of Ben-Gurion and Israeli Airport Authority. Mr. Geffen served in the role of director of security division since May 2011. Apart from the operational responsibilities, he is part of the management of the airport's management and Israeli Airport Authority. His practical and operational experience is as a team project leader in planning, implementing the security of the new Terminal 3, the main terminal of the Ben-Gurion Airport, and he worked on airport security domains, explosives, detention systems, and numerous angles of aviation security in Israel. So, please.
All right. Thank you, Gilad, for inviting me over. My name is Zohar Geffen, as mentioned, and I will start also with a short story, a real one, from the ground floor this time. 2016 was a very unique and important year in aviation security or in airport security. This year was after the Ataturk Istanbul attack, the airport, after the 7/10 Brussels attack, the airport and the subway, after the Russian plane bombing over Sinai, after the Somalian airport, aircraft that was bombed in Mogadishu. And this year we had a lot of calls and requests for advisors and professional assistance in Ben-Gurion Airport Security from all around the world. And we decided to conduct a landside security conference in Israel, international. It was last June 2016. And we had plenty of visitors all around the world. We had visitors, I think, more than 200. We had to close it, the registration, because we had too many. And the first evening, the gala evening of the conference, it was 3 days conference. After I left the gala, it was very successful. We celebrated all the audience and all the crowd and all the security managers. And there was, I remember that the chief of police in Ben-Gurion Airport called me on the way and said it was an attack in Sarona, which is a shopping mall, a shopping area in Tel Aviv. And it was right after the gala evening of our conference. And imagine all the guests that came from all around the world to the safe city of Tel Aviv, the safe country of Israel, which is expert in security and aviation security and landside security, and we are the experts in security, all kinds of security, cyber security, and all the rest. And in the first night, we had this bombing. And it was unfortunately a very bad one, because 3 terrorists came from Israel with handmade guns and to the center of Tel Aviv, actually, and did a very successful, from their point of view, attack inside Tel Aviv. And this is how it started, and it shows how it is complicated and how there's no 100% security in our field. And even when you think that you have a very good system of security, there's no 100% security. So let me start by my presentation regarding Ben-Gurion security, and I will add the innovation issue all around it inside the presentation. Let me start with a short introduction. First of all, a few words about us. We are the Ben-Gurion Airport. We are part of the IAA, the Israel Airports Authority, and the security division is part of Ben-Gurion Airport. We are a medium-sized airport. We have about 20 million passenger annual traffic, passenger volume, and we have more than 140 operating airlines at the airport. And on peak days, we deal with more than 100,000 passengers. This summer, we are in the peak. We have an increase in about average 70% in the passenger volume this year, which is enormous for us. And we are, as much as we are in security problems or issues in Israel and some tenses that goes with us to the region and to Israel, the passenger volume movement is increasing the whole time. We actually reopened this new terminal, Terminal 3 in Ben Gurion Airport, in 2004, and we have more than doubled the passenger capacity since then. So this is a very successful business. And we are located in the center of Israel on highway number 1 between Tel Aviv to Jerusalem.
All right.
So, this is something. Yes, I'm sorry, but this is ground floor. Okay, I'm talking from my point of view. So we have in Ben-Gurion Airport roads and parking lots, terminal buildings, passenger halls, runways, and many other facilities as part of the 43 square kilometer airport complex. The airport is a civic place open to the general public, but the entrance is granted only after security check. You cannot enter even the public side of the airport without going through the two gates to the airport. Let me show you something. All right. So these are the two entrances, and we are controlling these two entrances. You cannot get into the airport only by us. Now we have three basic assumptions for security in the airport. First of all, we are a strategic national facility. Actually, Ben-Gurion Airport is the one and only international airport in Israel. All traffic, all the passengers coming to Israel is going to Ben-Gurion Airport. If you close this airport, you can get into Israel only by the bridges and Jordan, and you don't want to be there. So this is the first one. The second, that we are all the time under a constant threat of terrorism, Ben-Gurion Airport. And we understand that Ben-Gurion Airport and the civil aviation constitute a prime target for terror attacks. And the last one is that we have to cope and comply with national and international regulations set by the local regulators, the Israeli police, the ISA, and the international regulators. Now, the government of Israel has placed in the hands of the IAA their responsibility for all security aspects in the airport, which means landside security as well as passenger security. So this is a key element in our security concept to control everything. It's our full responsibility to prevent any form of attack on board aircraft taking off from Ben-Gurion Airport, to protect and secure Ben-Gurion Airport grounds from terror attacks of all kinds, and to ensure the functional continuity in routine and emergency. This concept of full control on all security aspects of the airport allows the normal daily aviation, daily activity and flow of passengers and visitors at the airport, along with tight and updated level of security. Our challenge is to maintain high level of security while enabling the normal daily life and aviation and commercial activities at the airport. To do the job, we hire hundreds, I can say more than 1,000 security staff, men and women, all after military service. We run our own security academy, and we conduct most of the security courses ourselves. Now, only few airports in the world face terrorist threats more serious than Ben-Gurion Airport. Unfortunately, Ben-Gurion suffered some deadly terror attacks during the years. Actually, the establishment of the security division was in the year of 1972. after a deadly terror attack at the airport. In that terrible massacre attack on May 3rd, 1972, 26 people have been killed, and dozens were injured in the international arriving hall at the airport. So it is our routine working assumption that we have to cope with constant and evolving threat of terrorism. Now, we have a professional approach towards all security domains at the airport, and our professional approach believes in common sense security, meaning risk-based security in all security aspects. And this is very dynamic. We use proactive and preventive approach. We have holistic and conclusive protection, front door and back door. And having security as part of the airport designing, this, by the way, can save you a lot of money if you pay this money. The security program in Ben Gurion consists of three main elements. M stands for method, updated regulations and security procedures. E stands for technology, state-of-the-art security systems. And the most important, the H, stands for the human factor, well-trained, motivated, and skilled security staff. We believe that this is the most important element in the system. We're talking about combining between technologies and human factor. Literally, this is the only element in the system that can look terrorism in the eyes. Having said that, and the fact that we use many security technologies and systems, still the human eye and touch remains a central element in our security perception today and in the future. We have a method. The situation of high and evolving threat of terrorism brought us to take, as I said, a proactive approach, a plan, a comprehensive layered security program that protects our airport in total, from perimeter, access roads, to passenger checkpoints. Comprehensive layered security program that enables us to tighten security, as these layers move closer to the passenger terminals and the aircrafts, which are our main protected areas. These layers are dynamic, and we change and adjust the methods of operation according to the security situation, intelligence assessment, and other security factors. I will go briefly over the main domains of landside security. So the first landside security, when you come to Ben Gurion Airport, as I said, controls the entrances to the airport. The entire airport complex is surrounded and protected by an electronic fence, double fence, that prevents unsupervised entrance to the airport grounds. The two vehicle gates to the airport are controlled and secured by us. We screen all incomers into the airport. Drivers and vehicles which are suspicious are directed aside and for a comprehensive check. We use several measures there, K-19s, under vehicle surveillance systems, and PPDs, and when we control these two gates, kilometers away from the crowded terminal halls, means that we can deal with the arrival far away. This is a very important element in our landside security concept. We are protecting our public areas with an alarming solid fence, that are insecured by ground mobile patrols that reacts very quickly to any emergency or all sort of event that happens in the gates. We are guarding our crowded public areas and the passenger terminal halls, which consists of a very sensitive spot and prime target for mass terror attacks, as we saw in Brussels, as we saw in Istanbul. And we are taking several measures in order to mitigate this threat. We are using the landside facade and protect it with borers that prevent some cars from ramming into the terminal halls. We use blast-resistant trash cans, which are located along the terminal facade, in the terminal halls, in all the public areas of the airport. The glass screen wall on the terminal landside facade is fortified to withstand an explosion. We guard all the entrances to the terminal building. We are manning them and with security personnel. We screen everybody that is going into the terminal halls. And entrances which are closed and which are not in use, of course, are completely closed. If you can remember the Russian taking the Domodedovo airport, this is something that we took from there. Which are controlling the ground facade and terminal halls and reacts directly to the security command and control center. We also have undercover security agent at the airport, which are situated in the terminal halls and ground facade to provide immediate response to any evolving attack. The response to an evolving attack scenario is immediate and accurate. And say it. As I said, we have a comprehensive layered security program, so we also talk about the insider threat and the access control system and access control checking is essential for airport security. All airport employees have a full background check before getting badges. It allows them to get into the restricted areas of the airport. The entrance of employees to the restricted areas is allowed only after verification of the employee identity, also with biometric system, which is something which is very hard to bypass. Metal detection body scan, X-ray scanning for the employee bags, etc. Now let's move closer to our most protected issues, and let's talk about passenger security. So I think that this is the most sophisticated area in aviation security. Why it is so sophisticated? Because here you have to find the arrival, the attacker, which looks completely normal as a normal passenger, between thousands of passengers which are going now to the airport, to security, to the airport, to other things in the airport, and its target is the airplane. It's not the airport itself, and they're going to attack your airport, they're going to get into the plane. Now, the attacker could be young radical Muslim, like the 9/11 attackers. It could be also a young pregnant Irish woman, like Anne-Marie Murphy, which was one of the 273 passengers on board the live flight, flying from Beirut to London, on April 86 with a bomb in her belongings and her bags. The terrorist can be an attacker, but can also be an exploited passenger, carrying a bomb without his knowledge. The terrorist could even be an airport employee, the insider threat. And these are completely different cases for passenger security with completely different solutions. In order to mitigate this threat, I will explain a little bit about how we deal with this sophisticated threat. We have three stages for passenger security in Bangalore Airport. First, we have short personal security interview. Then we have a baggage check through the HBA system, anyhow, all the passengers going through the HBA system. And third, we have our checkpoint. One centralized checkpoint in the airport. So the security starts with human personal interview done by security agents. Let me demonstrate.
Yes, please. Hi, from Airport Security. I'd just like to ask you a few questions regarding your safety and safety of the flight.
Is this luggage yours?
Yes.
Passport, please.
How do you pronounce your name?
Hadab.
What was the purpose of your visit to Israel?
Business and tourism.
How long did you stay here?
4 days.
Where did you stay?
Tel Aviv and the Dead Sea.
Hotels or private houses?
Hotel.
Do you know anyone in Israel? Friends or family?
No.
Who packed your luggage?
I did.
Since it was packed until now, where has it been?
With me all the time.
Did you receive any gifts or packages while you were here?
No.
I'm asking because in the past, people have received items that look innocent but contain explosives. Do you have anything in your handbag that looks like a weapon? Anything sharp? Scissors, knife, pocket knife?
No.
In your handbag, do you have any creams, powders, liquid, or gels?
No.
Please remember to keep your luggage unlocked. Have a pleasant flight.
Thank you.
All right. So we interview each and every passenger personally, and we determine the level of check, level of security, personally to each person, each passenger. Now, it looks very easy. Usually it takes less than a minute. But this interaction between the security agent and the passenger is the best than all technologies. Right? Think about the attackers in the last decade, three decades ago, since starting from the 70s until now. And we know for a fact that some terrorists in the past were very nervous towards this security procedure, this one-on-one security interview. Of course, in that stage, we have to decide, do we really have a security problem with the passenger or not? And if yes, what we can do with it? And of course, that we can do everything, because we have the passenger with us. We can investigate if he's driving alone, who's driving with him. We can check into our scanners and technologies, and we have the whole time. All the time in the world, we have with us. So this is a very important stage in passenger security. The security process continues with the inspection through our HBS system, old baggage screening system. This system is operating since March 2014. After a long professional pilot test, this is a unique and Israeli system. We have planned it. It is an automated security check system for inspection of passenger luggage. It is a multi-layered security system, several layers of technologies, scanners and unique screening software. Our test proves that it provides high level of security and meets all the standards and criteria for explosive detection. Last stage, passenger security at the checkpoint. You use the checkpoint for the passenger and the hand luggage, scanned by a variety of security technologies. PTDs, explosive threat detection, metal detection gates, body scanners, standard metal detector for inspecting the passenger shoes, etc. Now, last second that I would like to show you, because we talked about front door and back door, a comprehensive layer security program. So it talks about the incoming flights security, and as you understand, the terror history in Ben-Gurion consists also affects in the arriving passenger area. Therefore, the security program in Ben-Gurion includes some measures to protect also the incoming passengers from the moment of landing. We have an exclusive team in our security shift, operational shift, which is responsible for secure all incoming passengers. We screen all the incoming passengers to Israel at the airport. Of course, our team is ready to respond to any evolving attack scenario all along the arriving passenger trail. Now, it was a very brief and short presentation on a nutshell of the security sectors of the Ben-Gurion Airport. I can tell you that I'm in this field of the Israeli HLS system since more than 20 years, and the difference between what we had 2 years ago, 3 years ago, 4 years ago, before the Mutale attack with carrying the bomb in his belonging, and after it. It is an evolving system. Passenger security, landside security is evolving all the time. So it looks very simple. Some of the things that we have in the airport, of course, are not allowed, and we cannot show to the public. You have to understand what you saw is only a part of the security that remains in the Ben-Gurion Airport. Yeah. And make sure that next time that you come to the airport, you know a little bit more about passenger security and how to go to our security circles. And thank you very much.
Few quick reflections on Zohar's brilliant presentation. Thank you, Zohar. Firstly, as Zohar described the interview process when you arrive into Israel or when you leave Israel, I think an anecdote would be a friend, a mutual friend of me and many of my colleagues sitting here in the audience, some would identify, who's an ex-Scotland Yard, ex-British military intelligence, that is now an academic doing research for academic institutions in Afghanistan, Iraq, and other places. I'm always reminded whenever he comes to Israel with a suitcase full of books on how to prepare IEDs, etc., etc., he's always required to call someone he knows. It's good to know ICT personnel. Call your IDC or ICT friends when you arrive. A second, more serious reflection, obviously, as Zohar described, as we do not want to nurture and feed terrorist innovation, Zohar had to limit his presentation, which is also filmed here, so not to give additional ideas. And this is also why he limited his descriptions of terrorist innovation to past innovation in aviation security, rather than speak on contemporary one. I think the only feedback I will allow myself to mention is an adversary, empiric feedback. Word goes, I think that's the best type of feedback you get as security personnel. Word goes that when Richard Reed, the shoe bomber, visited Israel before he actually conducted the shoe bomb attack, he actually surveyed possibilities of security and literally reported back, Zohar can choose whether to confirm that, that there is absolutely no chance of conducting that in Israel, aviation security, thanks to Zohar and his team's work. So thank you, Zohar, for that. We now move to the not last, but last formal presentation. Time allowing, we will elaborate some more of the concepts we spoke of before, by Colonel Shlomo Mofaz. As it is said by Professor Benor, the dean and the director of the ICT, once you are retired as a general or commissioner in Israel, the senior ranking position above that is an ICT associate. So I would like to start presenting Colonel Shlomo Mofaz by first his role as an associate at ICT, researching here as well, at IDC Herzliya, but he's also the former head of the Counterterrorism Analysis Department at the Military Intelligence Directorate at the IDF. He is a vastly experienced practitioner. I was asked by him not to go through all his past positions, so I won't, and this one will benefit more from his insights.
I would like to talk about the challenges and the opportunities of terrorist and security and intelligence organizations in the close race between them. And the emphasis will be on the modern terrorism, and the most prominent phenomena in recent years, the vehicle arm and the stabbing terrorism, and the homegrown or lone wolf terrorism. Such events have occurred in recent years, fortunately here in Jerusalem, Tel Aviv, Nice, Berlin, Ohio, Stockholm, London, Barcelona, and more. Michael Dell said that technology is like a weapon lying on the table. Either a business picks up and uses it, or either competitors will. The same is equally to terrorists. Such advances are equally important to terrorists in their effort not only to outmaneuver counterterrorism forces, but also to launch new kinds of strikes that the targets are not prepared for. And now I would like to focus on prominent trends and phenomena and the shifting in global modern terrorism and the characteristics in the last years indicate a change in direction of global terrorism with emphasis on the Western countries, in Europe and other countries. And I would like to point out and emphasize three phenomena. The first one is the sophisticity. The second one is the privatization. And the third one is the global. So let me explain. The sophisticity, it means that the sophistication of secrecy. It means that terror attacks became less sophisticated regarding the shooting, regarding the stabbing, regarding the vehicular terrorism, which we can call some kind of low-tech terror. They are also becoming more difficult to prevent, on the other hand. The vehicular terrorism and stabbing, it's nearly impossible to prevent. And almost anyone can get access to a truck or car with driving license can drive to a crowded area and target civilians. It's simple, it's easy, it's cheap, you don't need a lot of money, and it's easy to hide your intention. On the other hand, terrorism has been privatized. Anyone can carry out a deadly attack, what we call lone wolf or lone attackers. You don't need an organization, a command and control, no prior approval from senior level, no need for prior knowledge, experience, training. There is a short time between decision and execution. Short exposure time to early warning and detection. Sometimes the terrorist himself does not know even the night before that he will carry out an attack day after. So in this context, I'd like to mention that following the attack in Nice that killed 86 people in July 2016, the Islamic State published a guide for would-be attacker, noting that the vehicles are extremely easy to acquire and unlikely to arouse to suspicions of citizens and authorities. The local, they are part of the community, these guys. Okay. The local is means that the ideology is global, spread by technology, but the execution is local. People associate themselves with an idea, not necessarily with an organization. It's very important. Jihad against the infidels worldwide, establishment of caliphate that will rule the world, and so on. They are part of the community using technology. The Islamic State of Mind supporters. They have conceptual affiliation, self and local recruitment, not necessarily an organization. The use of technology and advanced means, the internet, the social networks, to generate two things. The ecosystem, the social radicalization, and the ecosystem, mobile radicalization, and social isolation and self-radicalization. The evolution of the internet jihadism points out points out that the complete revolution represented by the bomb of the specific visual storytelling, the violent videos, infographics, the images, reinforced the cultural impact of the pseudo-religious message by the internet, by the technology. The influencers, who may or not may have formal ties with a major jihad group, have also taken advantage of the new media landscape. They disseminate jihadi material and rhetoric, and the mirror effect of the individuals became either inspired or realized by consuming this material from their computers without necessarily having any direct links to jihadist lyrics or groups. That gives the jihadism the power to reshape reality by technology, by the internet, alter the declared religious and cultural roots, to elaborate and celebrate the cult of the jihadi wolf as a sort of superhuman fighter. The jihadi wolf is not weak, and it's not alone. He's alone on the ground, but he has a community. Just think of the cultural and globalized dimension of terrorist narrative inspiring and promoting the lone jihad against the West. He is completely mobile connected and immersed into the magmatic interacting and socializing jihadi sphere, which is the terrorist inosphere, produced by a massive uploading of open jihadist multimedia products. The execution is local, underground, mainly in Europe and Western countries, according to local opportunities and circumstances. Local terrorists with second and third generation to immigrants with local citizenship know the area, speak the language, know the local culture and mentality, but also have a cultural connection to the growing number of jihadists, provides them with an advantage and supportive environment. That makes it difficult to locate them by the authorities, and the local citizenship provides them with a kind of protection under the umbrella of human rights. When you speak with security experts in Europe and other places, and you ask them why you don't change the law or the other thing, they say this is because of the human rights for a democratic country. The challenges of security, intelligence, and officials, on the other hand, is so, of course, to solve them. But the problem is that there are very few early signs, if any, what we call in the intelligence language, low signature. It's very difficult in early warning. It's hard to locate them geographically. It's global call, again, but the execution is local. They are part of a local population. They are multilingual, especially in Europe, makes it difficult to keep track of potential suspects. Against vehicular and the stabbing, you need the mitigation measures because the prevention is very difficult. So in that manner, the intelligence challenges, as of course, intelligence, as you have seen before by my colleagues here, has a central role in counterterrorism. But the problem today is that, as you've seen some examples, excellent examples before, the open source increased, and it's including the web intelligence, and the social media intelligence. And apparently, there is a contradiction from the intelligence point of view and the intelligence activity. Intelligence usually is a secret organization whose methods of operation must not be exposed. And on the other hand, a dramatic increase in the part of the open information in the context of terrorism and preparation of terrorist attacks. So you have a huge amount of information which we call big data. Just to explain to people that are not familiar with it, big data means very shortly, there's a lot of explanation, three V's. The volume, extreme amount of data, the variety, number of types of data, structured, unstructured data, video, voice, images, data, tracking, location, and so on, and the velocity, the speed of data processing, and again, you've seen some very important examples. And difficulty in detecting early signs, the intelligence are very big difficulties to monitor networks in here if there is no lead. If you have a small lead, it's very easy. But the next challenge is to fuse all this kind of information. You need to integrate the various information types. You saw here some examples of Facebook and the open source, but there's other kind of sources. You need to identify connection between events, distributed data, databases, and geographic information, which we call a GIS system, geographical information system, in real time. And real time is very important. So for that, just to mention two very important advanced tools that was already mentioned, the semantic text analysis. It means the use of ontology to analyze content in web resources. It combines text analysis and semantic web technologies. And the sentiment analysis that is in the last year more and more in the intelligence services aims to determine the attitude of a speaker, writer, or other subject with respect to some topic or the overall conceptual polarity or emotional reaction to a document, interaction, or event. It's not only for intelligence, also for commercial issues. For example, if Lionel Messi just launched a new shoes and you want to see what is the reaction on the internet, people like it or don't like it, and then you can you have commercial business to do it. The same in the intelligence for counterterrorism. For that, there is a need for interaction between the civil and the security market. And the example that you see from the private companies here just emphasize this point that if 20 years ago the intelligence communities were close to their technology, today there is a lot of interaction because the private market are going forward very quickly with technologies, and you saw some examples here, very good technologies that the intelligence and the organization are adapted this technology. So for that, the intelligence, when you need to fight the terrorists at the end from all kinds of sources, not only open sources, all kinds of sources, all intelligence that you have, you need to create entities for the from accumulated information. So what you need is one entity, one ID of a terrorist or suspect based on the entities you have already in your databases, and intelligence has a lot of databases, documents, binder, files, whatever, real-time information from open sources, from darknet, from secret information, and information from all other databases of organization, Ministry of Defense, Homeland Security Office, and whatever. At the end, you need an identity. So as far as you have more information, not one source, multiple sources, you can have more information about an ID, about the suspect, about his connection. So let's go now and see what is the future on the terrorist mind in the kind of what kind of trends. Global jihad and especially the Islamic State have a deep understanding of connection between the world of communication, social media in particular, and the operational world. They understand the wide range of civilian technologies that they can be applied to their own benefit using social media to conduct global operations. They can use high-tech and low-tech, as we have seen, combination. It's low cost, it's raw, it's public, and let's see some examples. Exploitation of microblogging and social media platform to identify potential easy and crowded targets to attack. Thanks to the massive connection of young supporters in Europe, for example, with the mobile devices. So you can find crowded areas without going out of your home. 3D videos, attacks can be shared by mobile devices, or let's say GoPro-style attacks, disseminate on live streaming. It's possible, the technology is there. So imagine you see a live attack in GoPro. It's not an imagination, it could happen. Or the IoT, what I mentioned before, the automated management system of houses, vehicles, wearable devices within the upcoming Internet of Things, the IoT, or multi-rotor drone, you can invite from the internet, you can buy it, it's very simple. So you can collect information with it, you can do the surveillance, you can do an attack with it, and also a live broadcast of an attack. And of course, 3D printing of tools and devices, and the simple things of acid and toxic and poisons and the other things that you can get very easily. In this context, I would like to note a possible escalation in this data. The collapse of the Islamic State, it's a possibility of escalation from quality and quantity. And attacks in the West, mainly in Europe. Trained fighters, we're talking about thousands and thousands, with experience, knowledge, and sophistication, return to their countries of origin in the West, especially to Europe. They can recruit and train new members and use advanced abilities that they bring with them from the Middle East. On the other hand, because it seems that the Islamic State don't have a lot of good results in the last months, disappointed what we call potential Jews who wanted to enlist the Islamic State and did not have time to travel to the Middle East, will carry out attacks by the name of Islam in their countries or neighboring countries, and attacks by women. Until now, there's only few, but in ISIS, in Syria and Iraq, there was a woman that fought in Syria and Iraq. From the other hand, the technological countermeasurement, let's take some examples. First of all, when we are talking about vehicle terrorism, increased surveillance in rental companies, like passenger database, at least in airlines, we have databases, blacklist, whitelist, and so on. You can do also rental cars all over the world. Various electronic means of remotely shutting down vehicles exist already and could be employed to prevent vehicular attacks. Robot security guards, I'm not sure in Israel in the airport, but this is a possibility in other places. And a crowdsource information coming from the crowd. This can help ensure a better flow of information between citizens and the intelligence and security forces, especially in times of emergency. With access to social media, passive passerby can be active citizens, journalists and others, providing and delivering real-time information from the ground through their mobile devices and can provide near real-time situational awareness. And my last slide about technological countermeasure, the artificial intelligence that was mentioned, two short examples. First of all, simultaneous translation in human level and translation of multiple languages in real time. And we know that in Europe they have a very big problem with languages because people from second and third generation speak the local language, but also speaks Arabic, but not Arabic in different from different countries. The one from Morocco speaks differently a little bit from one with Tunisia or from Egypt or from Iraq. And artificial can be applied to social media. Sensors that collect biometric and other data connected to the mesh network. So the artificial intelligence early warning system can predict planned events in specific location. And the last one, the counter surveillance, maintaining detailed records, especially photos of suspects, activists that can be shared by authorities and when appropriate time disseminate to the public using mobile phones in real time in an event, it can be instrumental to identifying and locating persons of interest for law enforcement in real time. Imagine there is an attack and there is a suspect that maybe the authorities knows about them, they can spread the pictures of the people of the suspect to the, all the people that's in one located in the event. If someone saw him, he can immediately push the button and say, I saw him, and they can know the place. This is some examples, of course there are more, but this is not imagination, the things that organization, private sector are working on that, and this is some kind of, again, the combination between the private market, the innovation in the private market, and the innovation and capability of intelligence and security organizations. Thank you.
Okay, I think that Shlomo nicely weaved together some of the elements we heard of before when he spoke, for example, on AI, and then connecting to systems such as cobwebs and mirrors. Just a second.
Do we have copyright in a second?
Of course. We all use it. That's his copyright. Don't use his. Technology is always delaying us slightly. Okay, so I think what we heard from Shlomo is a nice entwinement of what we started from. And we heard of the way that technology could be put to practice in counter-terrorism, not just fight the risk. The example of AI, I think, is brilliant. We could even connect to contemporary innovations by private sector, by Google. Google today is innovating the Google Street View cars, if you heard of that. The reason is exactly AI. The reason they're doing that is to make sure that in our future searches, we can search more human-like questions. Show me the pink store that is near the stores, the crossroads, that and that. But that plays out nicely when you think of systems like cobwebs, mirrors, and others that are emerging that try to instill AI into identifying, like the example that we showed, regretfully technology didn't play out, but I saw the movie, so it's worth seeing, that a piece of a picture in a certain mosque somewhere in Birmingham, in fact, plays out to connect to some other picture somewhere on the web, which supposedly is absolutely unconnected or in the dark, as we've seen from earlier. So I think it nicely weaves it all together. What I would like to propose to all of you in this academic environment, I think we have enough time, not just for the Q&A and the panel discussion that we planned. If you would allow me, and if you think that's interesting and interested, I would like to throw maybe two or three more tools in understanding terrorist innovation from the toolkit of a full seminar and course on that. If that's all right with you, I could do that in something like 2, 3, 4 minutes, and then we could move to the Q&A. Would you find that useful? Okay, so let's do that. I apologize as I'll be jumping between topics and slides. I won't open all the relevant concepts of innovation in terrorist organizations and encountering them, but I'll mention just a few. So firstly, I'll try to go back to the notion that I started introducing, the concepts and the speakers, and I'll go back to the group of researchers working in 2010 on definitions of innovation in terrorist organizations. As I mentioned, that they refer to tactical, strategic, and organizational innovation, all are very evident in all the examples described by the various speakers throughout the day. By the way, the mortars shot that Magnus described in Britain were a development by PIRA that insisted that they would not purchase mortars, but rather develop the know-how, innovative know-how, which they purchased the know-how externally to develop a capability of mortar producing that became a core competency of PIRA along the years. So organizations, innovative such as PIRA, understand the value of learning and creating the innovative capability inside. That's just a notion. However, I wanted to remind us of that definition and work of the group in 2010 because of another issue. They also mentioned, the expert consensus was that terrorist innovation is often a product of gradual, incremental synthesis of earlier innovation and earlier learning. As I mentioned before, the running idea is that innovation is not just innovation. By the way, they prove it using
That's the phase that was earlier. Now I jump to the preferred side, I apologize for that. They used various attacks that we are all well familiar from the history of terrorist attacks and terrorist innovation, from the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, which was innovative in aviation security, in hijacking airplanes, putting together earlier innovation like non-political airplane hijacking and internationalizing a local event. More interestingly, I think their example of the ETA, the Basque movement, and their attack, which by the way was inclusive of many tactical innovations, but was a strategic innovation in the fact that it assassinated the attack, the prime minister at the time for about half a year. And the way that they implemented their previous knowledge and innovation is because they had prison escapes through tunnels. So they implemented it to dig the tunnel under the road that the car of the prime minister was about to drive on. So without that prior knowledge coming from how to dig a tunnel below, the car of the prime minister wouldn't find its way as it did in this picture up to the rooftop and eventually to the end. So innovation is not just innovation. It's based on accumulated learning, on what you learned in previous attacks empirically and in open innovation externally from other organizations as well. Okay? Without developing that example, developing our good friend and colleague Asaf Mogadan, who now is a visiting professor at CTC, West Point, but is leading our academic program at ICT. He has a fabulous paper on Al-Qaeda's innovation, which he analyzed as a bottom-up innovation. And I would add to that, with this agreement as we presented it together to my students, it is also open innovation, because in fact the source for the innovation for 9/11, for Bin Laden, was KSM, who was not a formal Al-Qaeda operator. So in effect, it's Bin Laden's kind of soliciting in open innovation sources of innovation which are outside. It's like today's angels investing in business arenas, in startups. You bring the good ideas to me, I will fulfill it. But we don't have time to develop open innovation. I actually would like to show you an example, as Shlomo mentioned, the quadcopter that could become useful. In fact, 3 years ago, we had a panel on terrorist innovations. Brian Jenkins was speaking next to me, and Gary Ackerman and many others. And there, one of the ideas presented was of the usage of quadcopters by terrorists. In fact, that has already been the case, and vastly so. So let me show you that example after I show what incremental innovation is all about. To show incremental innovation, I like to use a paper written by Thomas Nanke, who also an American professor who was very senior in the Defense Department and also spoke here in conferences in the past. Thomas Mankin has a fabulous paper, in fact it speaks on the Chinese military innovation, and I presented that in China as well, his paper, but I like to apply it to terrorist innovation. He relates to various degrees of innovation, which starts from just duplicative imitation, continues to creative imitation, creative adaptation. At the end, you have what we like to think as the eureka moment, the radical innovation. Let me exemplify his approach, and the approach generally of incremental innovation. And that's the message I want to relate to. So this is duplicating innovation. This is not Starbucks. This is Star and Bucks in Ramallah. Seriously, it's there. I don't think they're being sued for royalty. Not yet. But this, you would agree, is innovation for the Ramallah owner of the coffee shop, which is duplicating. It was exactly that. Let's look on another type. Let's go up the spectrum, and let's look in this approach where the model, which is why I like it very much, related to technology, doctrine, and organization, but it clarifies, it demonstrates clear categories that are adaptation as phases and part, inherent part of innovation. So this is why I prefer that model. And same thing, let's go to radical innovation in the model. This is the Ariel's group, Leonardo da Vinci. Who better to exemplify what real radical innovation is, okay? And with that said, the aerial scoop, the helicopter, as we know, was at the time radical innovation, we would all agree, okay? That said, I'll take it in a second to Shlomo's example and what we spoke of 3 years ago of the quadcopter, because, to quote Farrell in his military adaptation, it's not feasible or fruitful to draw a fine distinction between adaptation and innovation. And I agree with it. It is more like a slider. Imagine a slider of these 7 degrees okay? And in this standard, you start with duplicative imitation, you continue to, let's say, architectural innovation. Architectural innovation is, for example, the Sikorsky helicopter. It is innovative in the different architecture, in the different structure. But hey, it's not Sikorsky's idea, it's Leonardo da Vinci, who was radical. So the same thing can be radical innovation for someone else it's architectural innovation. And let us take these to the quadcopters, which all of us can buy, AliExpress or Amazon, use your favorite eBay, use your favorite retailer. I got my daughter's very cheap, caught commercial off the shelf, as any other terrorist or counterterrorism researcher can do. Very cheap, they use it in with a camera, they use it. Now that example, of course, could be both. So let me show you one case where it's duplicative imitation by the ISF, the Iraqi Special Forces and the Iraqi military. And in fact, who is using it as radical innovation? We can argue whether this is radical, but I argue yes, terrorist innovation. The case is very simple. Go to Mosul, not today. Go back time-wise to Merj. In Merj, the usage of what I used to call badminton bombs. These are badminton because they fall like badminton balls, you know? That's the only thing they do. Quadcopters bought through AliExpress, eBay. I don't want to make any commercials to any specific directions here, but buy whatever you wish. A joint, of course you have the camera with communication innovation so that you can take a video of that falling down and post that online as if you were the US Army. Although you're just someone that bought cards and innovate, but you can publish online. Links on Telegram, this is two examples I'm giving you again from the OSINT, the GID monitoring team, that show we are able to drop, by the way, dramatic 70 bombs in very short time in one sector over the Iraqi forces. So for them, this was radical innovation, usage of quadcopters. Who is them? Not the guys you see here, because the guys you see here are the Iraqi army. For them, it was literally duplicating imitation. They said, and they are saying it, very good idea by our adversary. We get support from the US Army, from others, from, yeah, but this idea is simpler, it does the trick, and we need to do that as well, and they did. So that's innovation in terrorism and counterterrorism. With that concept, because it can be both radical or duplicated, it is the power shift that the Tofflers anticipated that is created in our arena, the different ball game, or the ground, different grounds that we have now. It's not the usual soccer we play as hierarchies, as police organizations, as large governmental services. Today, each of the men of the year, you remember, Times Magazine put the men of the year, you, each of us, but it's not just you or me, it's also the terrorist operator. They are knowledge workers, to use Peter Drucker's terms, and they innovate daily. By the way, as Colonel Maurice told me once, they must do that faster than we, because for them it's a survival issue. For us, I know many people in many hierarchies, in places I consulted, not just in Israel, around the world, that until their chair is being measured for the role definition, may not innovate at all and remain in the chair. So with that said, I think that's one point which is useful for us to think of incremental innovation and the way it's done in terrorist organization. The other point I would like to bring very quickly to the table is the issue of disruptive innovation. I mentioned that before. Disruptive innovation is that. Disruptive innovation is not using something which is more sophisticated. It could be using motorcycles by the Syrian army because it's more appropriate to that environment. It could be a knife, the ramming, or anything alike. If we go to contemporary not even intelligence, this is out in the open, I'm based only on academic material. Contemporary facts emerging from Mosul. In the Mosul University, once it was recaptured by Iraqi forces, as today we know from Western sources that operated there with them, in fact, there were experiments, chemical innovation, we spoke on that, Hans said before that, chemical innovation by ISIS, by Daesh, using experiments testing deadly chemicals on live victims, horrendously. And the chemicals were thallium sulfate, which is part of pesticides, nicotine. So the chemical was not the sarin of the Om Shur Yoko, very sophisticated, which for their apocalyptic agenda, they, as you rightfully pointed out, were tending to chemical, before that attempts to radiological,
Here we see about 14 to 15 attacks, chemical attacks, in the area of Mosul, which went unnoticed. I think none of you were aware of it. So they're simplified agents for chemical attacks, but they are exactly that destructive innovation. By the definition of Clayton Christensen, the professor who coined the term destructive innovation, it's going a step backwards. The Celeron CPU, as it relates to, or the cameras in our smartphone, which is less sophisticated than the digital camera, but disrupts the industry as a whole. This is disruptive innovation, as in a way was the badminton bombs. I'll suffice with that, because I think now is a good timing to solicit questions from you, the audience. We are open in this amazing panel for your questions. My only question to all of us, above us all as an umbrella, is where is the future taking us? Where is the future taking terrorists? So they're taking us. Where do we take it as counterterrorism researchers and practitioner community? The floor is yours, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, question for Mr. Jimmy Hector. Often we're having incidents with lone wolf attackers, and we look back, I come from law enforcement, look back in retrospect in their activity on social media and so on. Does your technology have the capability, we talked about regression analysis and clustering, doing it on a go-forward basis, looking for a heightened sense of activity on someone using certain terminology or strings of words, creating a regression analysis, and then clustering to say, this person should be red alerted as someone we should be looking forward to prevent an attack, as opposed to always looking at it after the fact?
Yes. Okay, thank you for the question. So our technology is based on the search and analysis, so this is the history, what happened. And we have the, let's say, ongoing monitoring, and this is the real-time intelligence going forward, and it can be predictive analysis. So you can put alerts like dictionary. Just for example, now Harvey, like disaster management, it's not terror, so we just put a geofence on Houston and looked for the word help. And you can imagine the tweets that we got, hey, help me, I'm drowning with my children, 911 is not responding. This is my address. So I think, and this is the question that you brought right now, where are we going? We need to give a platform, a flexible platform, because of the challenges. Tomorrow it can be a fire in London building, and after that, a terror attack in Paris. And today the people, when they want to say help, or they're ready to rescue, it will go to social networks, because they're afraid to talk, because there's no network, but there is internet. So again, for the terror, yes, we can put keywords, and you'll get alert. And the keyword is over there, this is one. You can put dictionary in order to make synonyms. So cocaine is white, and drugs is candy, so it's same. So you can teach the machine all the time to be the same for your challenges, because challenges changes all the time. So it's already embedded, it's already working, it's already, we're trying to improve ourselves all the time, but this is something that already works.
So we have a position, sorry. If I could collect a few more questions and then give it to the whole panel.
Sure. Such a short follow-up. So today we have millions of hits on jihadi language, looking at hits in that regard, but being able to zero in on one closing in on a potential attack in the form, that's where I was sort of where I was going with regression analysis, clustering. But you made reference to a clustering to a significant spike of activity just before an event. Are we there yet in technology?
I think that we aren't there yet, just in the experience and the case study that we do it. So it's by use of the end users, we are specifically and R&D our system by the needs of the end users. So sometimes we say, hey, I need this one, then we are doing the customization all the time. So with experience and use cases, we're all the time adapting our technology to the new challenges. So I think that we're there technology-wise, operational-wise, we need to test it all the time in different scenarios.
I complement that by saying that if this was the part of machine learning, which it is, in machine learning you need the patterns so the machine can learn from, and this is what we're related to. So with your permission, I will collect quickly a few questions and then leave them to the whole panel. Sir, you had your hand in there?
Yeah, so it sounds to me like a lot of the discussion has been looking at what the moderator brought up about Tom Mankin's incremental types of innovation. Sounds like a lot of things that we are talking about are not necessarily at the disruptive or radical level. One thing I was kind of surprised that no one's talked about that I see could be a real game changer in terrorism is genetic manipulation. And I mean, because these technologies, as we've talked about a bunch of technologies, have become cheaper to use and available to non-state actors or terrorist groups. And things like CRISPR and other things could usher in a phase of terrorism that could target particular people groups, genetic things that we've not seen. Anybody on the panel want to talk about the possibility of the future?
I will leave that open to the panel for anyone to pick in a second. Additional questions? Yes.
Question to Mr. Shlomo Fass. You said about the remote shutting down of the cars. A year ago, I had the privilege to meet one of the owners of an Israeli startup that was dealing with this question. And he proved to one of the companies that is dealing with the security that there is a possibility for the defense and for the offense, that with giving a possibility for shutting down the car, we are not only giving bigger tools and bigger sphere for terrorists, but also we can create a situation where a person not even close to the car is able to, for example, stop officials. Or make that the fuel will not go, or is it the right way going to put so much technology in the world that we are not possibly protected properly? Because the time when we have to plug ourselves to computer are done, we can make it remotely, as Mr. Timanker or Levin said, we can make it from a different world.
I'll relate to that as an IoT, Internet of Things question. And let's collect one or two more questions so we have time. Yes, Robin.
All of the presentations today touched upon tactical, technological issues, not really strategic issues. And none of them touched upon incitement, on ideology, on identification of pre-pilot techniques, which I would call.
Thanks for that. We certainly believe that for the panel answers as well. One last question? Yes.
Can they predict where we will be in 10 years from today?
Super. That, I think, would be the panel one. That is read by everyone. Thanks, Gil. Okay, so 10 years from now. Let's see. We have genetic manipulation. We have... Oh, yes.
May I say something to Hauke?
Of course, very quickly, as we want our time.
No, very quickly. I'm in the business for many years, so in my opinion, in order to predict methods of aggression or innovation, are two levels, on the private level, individual level, and organization level. On the private level, to put yourself in the enemy's shoes in order to think where, why, and how. The best way to predict it reasonable, because he is not smarter than us. On an organization level, to establish red teams.
Thank you for that.
Our case,
I had to shorten your answer, otherwise we won't have answers here. Both very relevant and very important.
Let me finish one sentence as far
because
as red team. Red team is not only yourself, but to establish a team of 3, 4, 5 people, to give them a mission. You should sit down and do a brainstorming in order to think about those things. If you don't have enough money to
We buy it. Time-wise, I have to shorten comments and answers from the audience, so we have a few from
next
our panelists.
I'll finish.
For the panelists, genetic manipulation, IoT and cars from a distance, Rob's question on incitement and trying to identify things that are communication innovation, I would refer to it, and eventually where do you all think it will go in 10 years? Very quickly, whoever wants to pick each of the, any of the questions. So we want to start with your questions on the cars?
Regarding the cars, in the question you asked, you have the answer. The reason there is no, the technology out there, but you can't use it yet because there is no technology how to stop or avoid someone to take control from a car from outside. So even though you have the microchip in the car and then someone can take control of it, how to avoid the driver to take control after that? There, we are not there yet, and there is some technology to do it. And the second thing, You need to put the chips in the old cars, in the manufacturer's cars, or put it after the manufacture of the car. And it's not worldwide yet. So some ideas that was discussed in security organizations, in the level states, and commercial companies, and so on, but we are not yet there. I'm not sure that in the future, in 5 or 6 years, it will be relevant because there will be something else that we can expect.
Genetic manipulation, gentlemen, anyone wants to pick that up? So I'll just say that this is probably yet one more direction that needs to be explored, and certainly we will do that if there is an adversary activity and innovation which will twist our heads. Until then, it's possibly one more direction to think of. We have incitement and the communication theories, innovation and identity, and predicting them from Robbie. I'm able to pick that. If you, Magnus, will pick 10 years from now, where are we at?
I really don't.
I'll give you one more minute to think on that. I'll answer Robbie very quickly. There is a lot to say about that. Go and see, but time does not allow. Go and see Daesh created Lego toys that a Singaporean student of mine showed me that is being sold on AliExpress. And these are some of the incitements that are being done behind the curtains that you refer to. I believe there are ways to, using TradePol and other directions you are well familiar with, to identify where this is heading, but it would take much more time. We can discuss it later, as all the panelists would love to do with all of you. And Magnus.
Where are we 10 years? I don't know. Things I'm thinking about throughout your hearing all this great presentation, first of all, I think Israel is uniquely situated with its technological firms that we have, with the language skills that, that is here. So I think that you are well ahead of the curve. So hopefully you will assist with others on this issue. Things I think about in terms of those sort of headlines, I'm thinking about the choreography of the violence, of using, combining videos in real life. I think Shlomo was illustrating that with having filmed attacks on a much greater scale in a real brutalization way that we see daily from Iraq and so on. It's not shown so much in Europe. If you have an attack like that in Europe, that can create cascading effects in terms of, I think, polarization. The other issue I know in Europe that a lot of people are thinking about is the insider threat. People trying to get into security organizations, nuclear facilities, and so on. And that brings to the sort of issue of using implosion attack, attacks using weapons like 9/11, but in other ways and mechanisms. When I was here 3 years ago, or two, 3 years ago, we had some sort of briefing on the quadcopter issue, and I said it's just a matter of time before that graduates into maybe the Western sphere in order to circumvent security, because I think most are not adequately prepared to take on that. So I think that in that way, I think it's too early to really say, because technology is moving so quickly. And it's being harnessed and adapted in very sort of devious ways. But I'm happy to hear that that you are staying ahead of the curve here. I hope that that the rest of the West is also doing the same.
Thank you, Magnus, and thank you all this amazing panel of speakers. Please join me again in thanking the speakers. For the reason of time being what it is, as we could have continued the discussion and the questions for much longer, I think that the best advice I can give all of us is to convene here really again in 10 years at ICP, and see the innovations implemented until the experiment comes through. Thank you and enjoy the rest of the day.